So thanks very much, Christian, for a really nice introduction. It's true, my interests have kind of followed all the waves all along. So thanks also to the organizers for the introduction. It's great to be here again. This is really one of my very favorite meetings. And thanks to Anne for a beautiful talk and for helping me get started here, because there's some overlap with what Anne talked about in the beginning. So what I'm going to tell you about today is how colliding ribosomes function as a signal for activating cell stress response pathways. And I'll say that we came to this with initially with our interest in mRNA-specific quality control and how the ribosomes deals with problematic sequences. And we know that the collision from some early beautiful work from Hanny Zayer's lab, the collision ends up being a key signature that recruits factors to deal with mRNA and specifying quality control events. We stumbled on the idea that the collision might actually activate stress response pathways by some ribosome profiling work going on in the lab at the time, which showed that there was the activation of MAP kinase signaling pathways under stress. And we had a hint that there were collisions happening. I should say, though, that the idea about ribotoxic stress really originated from Bruce Maggin's lab, a professor at Oregon, who for decades worked on the idea that stalled ribosomes would activate stress response pathways. And what we really brought to this problem was some biochemistry and collisions. So in some beautiful work from Colin Wu, who was a postdoc at my time, which was published a couple of years ago, what Colin found was that collisions lead to the recruitment of at least two kinases in the cell, one very familiar to all of you, GCN2, from Alan Hinnebusch's beautiful early work, and also a MAP kinase, ZAC, which Bruce Maggin incidentally had identified. What Colin found was that these two kinases were recruited to the colliding ribosome under conditions of stress, leading to their activation on the ribosome. Like all kinases, they become phosphorylated. GCN2, as was highlighted, phosphorylates EIF2-alpha, John Hershey, leading to blocking ongoing translation initiation and the activation of this transcriptional program. Downstream of ZAC, it's long been known that ZAC activates at least two P38 kinases, one P38 and JNK, leading to different cell cycle regulatory events, either apoptosis, which is favored by JNK, and cell cycle arrest by P38, though these talk to one another. I should say that while we initially focused primarily on apoptosis in our initial publication, Ann Willis's lab had some beautiful data suggesting that a primary pathway for regulation was actually through P38 and cell cycle arrest. And finally, I should add that Simon Becker-Jensen, who's here in the audience, has also done lovely work along the way on ZAC and has made lots of contributions that I'll highlight. So just to get us all on the same page, I'll just lay out things that have already been laid out here. We use two different kinds of stresses to activate collisions in cells. We use intermediate doses of drugs, as pioneered also by Hanny Zayer, as well as UV stress. This also was pioneered by Bruce Maggin long ago, as well as by Nam Sonnenberg and apparently by Ann Willis, the idea that UV damage targets mRNAs and leads to collisions. So we use both these stresses. Anisomycin is a long-lived stress, whereas UV, you can expose cells to UV to trigger collisions and then take that stress away and look at recovery. So just to show you the sort of data that led to the model that came out in Colin's paper, what I'm showing you here is Western blots, untreated cells, anisomycin-treated cells, and UV-treated cells. You can immediately see the signature of collisions here with ubiquitination of ribosomal protein S10 with anisomycin and UV. You can see a potent response to both anisomycin and UV, both through ZAC phosphorylation. What's shown here is a phosphatag gel. This is relatively unphosphorylated ZAC. And with anisomycin and UV, you get this huge smear of activation of ZAC with these treatments. You can see that that activation is blocked by a ZAC inhibitor, but not a GCN2 inhibitor. You see downstream activation of P38 and JNK that correlate with ZAC activity. So that's the ZAC arm. This isn't quite as pretty, but you can also see here the activation of EIF2-alpha phosphorylation on this phosphatag gel, blocked by GCN2 inhibitor, but not ZAC inhibitor. So these are the sort of the basics that we came to at the end of Colin's paper. And at the end of that paper, what we were really trying to think about was the question, which is, how is it sensible for a cell with some number of collisions happening to activate all these pathways at once? These are clearly survival pathways. This is a bit of a survival pathway, and this is clearly not a survival pathway. And we reasoned that the cell maybe has a collision meter of some sort, so it keeps track of how many collisions there are and mounts a measured response. And yet we really couldn't get a handle on that in these initial experiments. And that's what I'm going to tell you about today, is how we've tried to get at a molecular mechanism or some mechanisms for how the cell regulates that response. Today, the work I'll tell you about is primarily the work of a postdoc in the lab, Niladri Sinha. He worked with another student in the lab, Jeff Lee, a student in Sergi Rougeau's lab, Connor McKenney, We worked a lot with Alban Ordero at MSKCC, who's a mass proteomics person, and Sergi Rougeau, my colleague downstairs, who's a mass MAP kinase signaling expert and has beautiful reporters that I'll show you. So it was a really wonderful collaboration. So we began by asking a simple question, which is if you expose cells to increasing doses of UV and measure either happily growing cells undergoing mitosis, those undergoing G2 arrest or apoptosis, does the cell actually distinguish between doses? Does more UV result in death and less UV result in recovery? And you can see that that's true. More UV results in more death. So it looks like the cell knows what it's doing. And so we wanted to set up a large scale experiment to ask that question. And it turns out when you study kinases, you have to look at phosphorylations and what's downstream of kinases to sort out those questions. So what I'm going to show you now is how we set up for a large scale proteomic experiment to get a molecular handle on what the signaling events were and what their timing was and how they were balanced. The lottery began by doing the experiment that, Anne showed you, which is looking for nuclease resistant diisomes in cells that were treated with UV or not. These are untreated cells. You can see that there's, with this dose of UV that I'm going to show you, there are very few diisomes initially. After 1 minute of treatment, you can see a substantial increase in the number of diisomes and trisomes. And you can follow that over time, 5 minutes, 15 minutes, 30, 1 hour, 2 hours, 3 hours. And at least in our cells in this treatment, these clear within about 3 hours. But we decided that the most interesting time points might be here where collisions were high and signaling would be potent. The lottery went on to look at Western blots to see where the signaling factors, where they were getting activated in this time course. And you can see at the top that ZAC phosphorylation is really robust and happens really quite early in this time course, as early as 5 minutes, 15 minutes, it's quite high. P38 and junk follow that activity. And nicely, you can see down here that DNA damage response effectors like gamma H2AX and PARP cleavage really come very, very late in this cycle, suggesting, as Anne indicated, that the cell really its first response is a ribotoxic stress response. So with these time courses in hand, the lottery chose to focus on this region here where ZAC activation was fully optimal and where things were developing. And he conducted a very large scale proteomic experiment using HCAT cells, which are keratinocytes and are naturally responsive to UV light. He dosed cells with UV and then looked at recovery times of 1 minute, 5 minutes, 15 and 30. We did phosphopeptide enrichment and we looked at the total proteome. And you can see from this principal components analysis that the data are really quite reproducible across time points and the data are quite clean. So what do you get out of this type of experiment? You get volcano plots, where on the x-axis, we're looking at phosphopeptides that are enriched. For example, here at 1 minute post UV treatment. So this is 1 minute over untreated. And to the left, things that go down. On the y-axis, significance. And what you can see if you start poking around is things that make sense. You see very early activation of ZAC, very early activation of P38 downstream of ZAC, and early activation of GCN2. That's just one time point. If we look at subsequent time points, 1, 5, 15, and 30, you see a veritable explosion of data. Alban can identify 50,000 phosphopeptides in this data set. And obviously what I've just shown you, which is cherry picking, is not going to work as a mechanism to figure out what's going on. So we've had to take a number of different approaches to try to figure out how to sort through those data to identify what you need to know, which is kinase substrate relationships in order to order events. So what we've done is we've done a bit of a clustering analysis. You can look at time courses and I'll show you some of that later, and that sorts things into groups. But the most effective things we've done is we've been able to look at sort of substrate product, kinase substrate relationships by using kinase inhibitors and knockout cell lines, as well as a technique to sort of sort through those data that I'll explain to you. So one of the first things Niladri did was he chose to repeat these experiments, these phosphoproteomic experiments at a 15 minute time point with a variety of different treatments. He used a P38 inhibitor, a junk inhibitor, a ZAC inhibitor, a GCN2 inhibitor, and additionally, we've constructed knockout cell lines lacking ZAC and cell lines lacking GCN2 so that we can compare the genetic and chemical inhibition. I won't tell you anything more about these data sets, but they nicely identify downstream substrates of those pathways that really have lots of interesting things from a ribosome perspective, but I'm not going to focus on them. What you can see here is that we have a problem still, though, because we've put in a ZAC inhibitor, for example. Now we have a huge cloud of spots going to the left that are sensitive to ZAC inhibitor, and we still have a problem of too many dots that we can't identify what's going on. And this is where a collaboration with Luke Hantley's lab was really useful. Luke Hantley's lab has recently purified 400 mammalian kinases. They then have slides, glass slides, onto which they array diverse peptides. They put in the individual kinases and P32 ATP, and they get patterns. And from those patterns, they can identify the consensus motifs for each of the mammalian kinases. And with those data, they can go into complex volcano plots and say who was likely most responsible for the spots that are seen. And that's been very clarifying and allows us to sort through really a huge data set. So what's shown here? Oh yeah, I'm good. What's shown here are the ZAC knockout compared to the ZAC inhibitor. And you can see immediately one simple conclusion is that these are very big, rich programs. There are lots of things downstream of the ZAC pathway. I can tell you if you compare these data sets, they correlate really nicely with one another. So the knockout reflects the inhibition with the inhibitor. But still, we have the problem of finding what the patterns are there. And what we did when we applied the Cantley analysis to these data sets is what you can see is that it greatly simplifies the data sets. And what the analysis says is that the primary things that are sensitive, the kinases that show up and the pathways that show up as sensitive to ZAC inhibition, are really the junk and the MAP kinase signaling pathways, which is exactly what I told you in the beginning, which is ZAC is known to be upstream of both P38 and junk. So this served as validation for the methodology. Everything's working. But I wouldn't say, at least in the simplest analysis, I'm going to share much more about that. The GCN2 data ended up being quite a bit more interesting. You can first see that when we look at the inhibitor data for GCN2, you can see that the program downstream of GCN2 is quite a bit more simple. There are far fewer dots, and that makes sense to most of you here. This is a very specific kinase with very few substrates. You can see things that are reassuring, like EIF2S2 and EIF2AK4. That's GCN2 itself and one of its known substrates. What you can also see is an explosion of dots over on the right. And those ended up being quite a bit more interesting. When we apply the Cantley analysis to this data set, you can see his analysis doesn't work very well for GCN2. We could talk about that later. What shows up strongly on the right here, first at the very top, is that there's a very large increase in TOR substrates. So these are all TOR substrates. And this is what's happening when you inhibit GCN2. So that suggested to us that there might be some reasonable pathway wherein GCN2 normally blocks mTOR activity, which in addition to this pathway that goes through EF2-alpha is another major way to regulate the rates of initiation in the cell. So the response of the cell to collisions is to turn on GCN2 to shut down initiation, to block further collisions from occurring. And GCN2 maybe regulates it in the same way, or in a different way, I should say, through the mTOR pathway, also shutting down protein synthesis through that pathway. So that kind of made sense. The other thing that you see emerging on this Cantley analysis is, again, the increase in P38-like substrates. And those are easier to find than junk substrates, suggesting to us that when we block this negative regulation of initiation by GCN2, this ZAC pathway gets upregulated. So there are more and more collisions and more hyperactivation of ZAC. So we went on to validate several of these ideas using a GCN2 knockout strain. What you can see here is this is a wild type strain. You've seen this before in disomes exposed to UV. In a knockout strain of GCN2, you see a strong increase in the number of disomes and trisomes, indicative of the fact that GCN2 is regulating this loading downstream of collisions. And that, I'm sure, is reassuring. We also look by Western blot analysis at some signatures. And this is, again, the GCN2 knockout strain, either with UV treatment over time. So you can see, first, you see a pretty substantial increase in this ribosomal protein S10, which to us is an indicator that TOR activity is indeed upregulated. TOR is responsible for regulating ribosomal protein synthesis. And when TOR is now deregulated, you're now making more ribosomes. We see evidence here also of increased collisions. This is ubiquitination of S10 that's increased in the GCN2 background. And finally, you can see signatures of increased ZAC activity here through the analysis of junk activation, where here it's quite low activity compared to in the GCN2 deletion cells, suggesting, in fact, this pathway is quite upregulated. We've used an independent way to look at this, and this was in collaboration with my colleague, Sergi Rougeau, downstairs. What Sergi has are some beautiful reporters that can follow the activation of kinases in real time. And this kinase reporter sits in the nucleus under normal conditions. So these are untreated Isomycin or UV treated cells. It sits normally in the nucleus and doesn't move. But when treated with an Isomycin or UV to induce collisions, you can see that the reporter moves out of the nucleus into the cytoplasm. And you can image that for hours at a time. So when we use that assay to look at junk activity downstream of collisions and as a function of GCN2, this is wild type first. What you can see is with the application of UV to these cells, this is the nice potent activation of junk activity downstream of collisions and sort of the decay of the signal over time. And in a GCN2 knockout strain, as we saw with the Western blot, you see an even more potent activation of that pathway. The collisions are not limited and the signal stays high for longer. And you would predict that with that higher signal, there should be more apoptosis in those cells. So the cells lacking GCN2 should be more apoptotic. And indeed, that's what we see. And we're now looking at percent cell death in response to UV. These are wild type cells. And the GCN2 knockout has really a very dramatic increase in the level of apoptosis downstream collisions. And that's blocked nicely, really very effectively by ZAC and by junk inhibitors and not by a P38 inhibitor. So I hope these data sort of convince you that we've learned a little bit about how these two factors in recognizing colliding ribosomes, not just independently, but talk to one another. And the activity of GCN2 is to limit collisions, which limits the activation of ZAC. And together they're working to sort of engage and make an appropriate response. What I want to tell you a little bit about now is a separate story that also comes out of these proteomic data. And that's about sort of how phosphorylation sites on ZAC are able to regulate its activity. So this is the primary sequence of ZAC, just to orient you. This is the kinase domain at the N-terminus. It has a leucine zipper and a SAM domain, and then a seemingly relatively unstructured structured C-terminal domain. But we know that there's a ribosome binding and sensing domain here at the C-terminus in work from Simon's lab as well as our own. So those are the domains. It turns out when you look at the data sets for phosphorylation of ZAC, there really is abundant phosphorylation, as you can tell from those gels. What you can see is we can identify as many as 36 different phosphorylation sites on ZAC. Some of them are flat over time. The heat map tells you about their height, and some of them vary over time. And so what we did is used a clustering analysis to identify patterns. And the first cluster is shown here. This is called cluster one. And you can see the levels of, there's some level of phosphorylation, but it stays pretty constant over the time course of the reaction. And if we look at the cluster one sites, they're distributed sort of all over the protein. Cluster two sites are here, and you can see they really have a nice sharp increase in their level of phosphorylation that begins to go down. And we know this mimics what we see for P38 pathway things. You can also see that this cluster localizes down here right next to the ribosome sensing domain. And so when we saw that, we wondered whether phosphorylation of those sites might somehow be involved in regulating the interaction of this protein with the ribosome. So we were excited about that. The third cluster is probably the least interesting. It comes up and stays high, but it's, you know, there's not very many of them and they're spread out. So when we looked at this list, Naladri proposed that he would make cluster mutants. I didn't think it was possible that anything would work, but what he proposed was making this huge cluster here of serines to alanines, this one and this one, and asking if there was any effect on the output from ZAC. So he did that. He made cell lines, he knocked out ZAC, and he put back in these various different versions of ZAC to see what the response would be. I'm going to show you one piece of data, and it's using this junk kinase reporter as a reflection of ZAC activity downstream of anisomycin stress. This is, again, what wild-type cells do. They have a peak activation, which decays over time. We have two different kinase dead variants. One is this is an active site mutant, and this is the activation loop mutant, and you can see neither of them respond at all to the collision stress. And you can see clusters one and clusters three, when mutated, really have no effect on the activation pattern. Cluster two ended up being quite interesting, however. What we saw was the activation peak was about the same height, so it wasn't more active. But it didn't, I should say, this is the all cluster. The red is all clusters together. But what we saw with the cluster two mutant is that the activity really didn't die, suggesting that ZAC doesn't know how to turn itself off. It knows how to turn on, but it's not turning off. We realized at that point, or we remembered, that in Simon's original paper, he had proposed that there was a phosphodegron targeting motif in the C-terminus of ZAC. It had a very strong consensus motif that it should be recognized or could be recognized by the Skiff-Cullen-beta-TRCP phosphodegron system, which is an E3 ligase, to target this protein for degradation. And so that provided a potential mechanism. This could be phosphorylated and then lead to degradation. Landry thought he had to explore that possibility. He started with an IP of ZAC, immunoprecipitation, to see what ZAC associates with upstream and downstream of collisions. And those data are shown here. You can see this is a pull down in anisomycin over untreated cells, things that associate more with downstream of collisions, and these are things that dissociate. And you can see a nice thing. You can immediately see that this FBXW11 is a known adapter protein for this E3 colon system. And so he was excited about that. It was consistent with the model. And he saw that to the left, the ribosomal proteins were enriched, suggesting that indeed, maybe ZAC falls off ribosomes downstream of collisions. So that raised the possibility that it suggested this model that ZAC is bound to ribosomes in the beginning. Collisions happens, it gets activated, it falls off the ribosome, maybe as a function of the tail, the cluster two, leading to phosphorylation or leading to recognition by the colon system and degradation. And I'll show you that both of those predictions turned out to be true. These are polysome profiles. We're looking at ZAC migration with ribosomes. You'll notice that in untreated cells, ZAC really very much moves with elongating ribosomes. When we treat cells with UV, what you can see is that wild-type ZAC begins to fall off, and you find it in the top fraction of the gradient. But the kinase dead mutant, nor the cluster 2 mutant, is seen to fall off. So as we predicted, when cluster 2 doesn't get phosphorylated, it doesn't fall off ribosomes. Landry also looked at degradation, and that's shown here. He probed cells or pulsed cells with anisomycin and looked over time, and you can see that ZAC is really very effectively degraded over time. Whereas kinase dead mutants are not degraded, clusters 1 and 3 are still degraded, but the cluster 2 mutant and the all cluster are stabilized. So this motif is critical for the stability and for targeting this protein for degradation. And what we can see is that if we add MLN4924, which is a known inhibitor of that system, the protein is indeed stabilized, as well as bortezomib, which is the downstream step. And finally, what I can tell you is that the cluster 2 mutant, which fails to be turned off because it's not degraded, is indeed more apoptotic in cells that are exposed to UV stress, as you would predict. I'm now going to tell you, I can never do math when I'm doing these things. I think I got it 7 minutes or four or three, something. So in a final experiment, I want to tell you another piece of information that we learned. We wondered why ZAC degradation would be useful. Why would you want to get rid of ZAC? And we reasoned that maybe the cell wants to get rid of ZAC to give itself some time to recover as a different mechanism to recover from that stress. So we did as an experiment to sort of look at tolerance. And so the first thing we did is we exposed cells, in this case, this is again the reporter, to stress. And you can see that the wild type and the cluster 2 mutant are unaffected. When we add UV irradiation, the wild type and the cluster 2 mutant are fairly similar in activity, with the cluster 2 mutant being a little more persistent. And as I've shown you before, under this regime, there's not much effect from the cluster 2 being more apoptotic, but this isn't the interesting experiment, this is the control. What we next asked is if we took the same cells and pre-treated them with anisomycin and waited over time to allow ZAC to be degraded in the wild type case, but not in the cluster 2 mutant, would those cells then subsequently be responsive or not to a second stress? So this is the treatment with anisomycin and the junk activation happening. But these cells were then treated after this time course with a dose of UV to see if they were responsive. What you can beautifully see is the wild type cells are no longer responsive as they're trying to recover, whereas the cluster 2 mutant cells are really still very potently activating this pathway. So they don't have the same time to recover. And indeed, those cells have an increased rate of apoptosis. They're no longer, after that second stress, they're no longer protected from this degrad system from recovering. So I'm going to close this and just summarize what I've told you, which is I started by telling you that we think cells are integrating collisions and making careful decisions. And what we think about this now is that there are sort of three different regimes that the cell is using to protect itself. In a first regime where collisions are low abundance, there's little ZAC degradation and probably phosphatases play a role here. And junk activity never gets very high, and the cells survive, and they have time to recover. So there's a threshold for cell death here. And that actually accentuates this pathway over here, the P38 pathway, which Ann Wills's lab had characterized, and the survival pathway and mechanisms for rescuing ribosomes and fixing things. In a second regime, where the collision number is intermediate, ZAC gets degraded over time, junk activity is high, but maybe not high enough to cross some critical apoptotic threshold. And this degradation of ZAC gives cells time to fix things, another couple hours to fix it before new protein synthesis takes place. And finally, in the final regime, where collisions are super abundant, ZAC degradation occurs quite quickly, but it doesn't really matter because the apoptosis threshold has happened and the cells are dying anyway. So these different regimes, these different molecular regimes for helping the cell to make these decisions. So I do want to take a few minutes. So that's the end of that story, and I want to indulge myself and just take a few minutes to tell you about biochemistry going on in the lab, because it won't be fair if I don't. So suffice it to say that we'd love to understand how ZAC works. We'd love to understand how it binds to ribosomes and what it's doing. And I'm just going to give you a few bits of information, and maybe you can ask me questions. The first thing I told you is that ZAC binds incredibly effectively to elongating ribosomes, and it falls off post-treatment. I told you that ZAC interacts downstream with the degron, and it falls off ribosomes. And I didn't tell you, but you will notice here 1433 is totally enriched with ZAC downstream of collisions. This is a known adapter for many kinases. The other thing I'll tell you is that cells have a lot more ribosomes than ZAC on average. So we've been thinking hard about how that might work mechanistically. And I'll just give you a little tidbit, and I hope you'll visit Vienna's poster. Vienna's been working on this problem with Marco. She has a huge problem. She has this protein clobbered with phosphates, and they make everything difficult. But she's been working hard at purifying protein. You can see this is a deletion series of ZAC here. This is full-length protein and a variety of deletions of the protein. And what you can beautifully see, this is actually 1433 protein that comes along with it. And you can see 1433 stops coming along with it when you get to this region here, suggesting immediately that somewhere in here, 1433 binds. She's found some nice motifs, and she'll tell you about those on her poster. But just to give you a feeling for the problem, this is the protein that she purifies from cells. It's wholly phosphorylated when you get it out. We can try to take off phosphates and get down to a basal level of phosphorylation. It's been pretty tough. But out of that comes something nice, which is when she does that, 1433 binding goes away. So she's got a handle on phosphorylation and 1433 binding and the beginning of some biochemistry to begin to explore mechanism. And I'll just leave you with this model for how we're thinking about it. We don't know very much about how ZAC acts biochemically. These kinases often dimerize, but not always. We don't know if it migrates as a monomer with ribosomes or as a dimer. We don't know if activation happens, you know, how the activation happens when collisions occur. We don't know what state it's in when it falls off the ribosome. Kind of what we know is that it meets 1433 downstream, and that's probably important for its activity. So these are the sorts of questions we'd like to think about, and we're working hard at getting to, and of course, we'd love to have a structure. So in closing, I'll just highlight a couple posters in my lab. I brought a big group this time. In the library, you've heard about Nicole, Esther, Franny, and Vienna all have posters that they'd love to share with you. Let me close by thanking again wonderful collaborators in the lottery for the work, Albin and Sergi for being amazing collaborators, Jeff, Connor, Marco, and Vienna. Thank you.
Thank you, Rachel, for a fantastic talk. Are there questions?
If you pre-treat, you mean if elongation is blocked, can collisions happen?
No. If collisions happen, you're showing or suggesting that initiation is downregulated. What about
LP? Yeah, that's a great question. We certainly in our, you know, everything's in our phosphoproteomics, but EEF2 kinase and EEF2 come up as phosphorylated, and that's definitely a way to regulate elongation. And I think that's thought generally to be downstream of TOR. So we definitely get a signature that the cell is working at that level as well.
I had a question about the phosphorylation sites and if you think they're all deposited kind of simultaneously or sequentially, and if that's part of the tunability of the system.
I think we don't know. I don't think we've done enough of that analysis. I mean, you see some of them come up very early. Nalandri may have more data at his poster that would get at that. I'm sure they come up sequentially and not all at the same time. I can tell you when you get it out of cell, they're all there. But yeah.
Thank you.
Sorry, Rachel. I was just wondering, so in the situation where you're increasing apoptosis,
I was wondering if you dial down translational initiation, would you then reduce the epitope?
Oh, that's a great question. Yeah, we haven't done that. That's a great idea. Great idea. We haven't done.
There are questions also from the online.
Yeah, there's a question from Alduin Surio saying, do you know whether SAC autophosphorylates itself at cluster 2? And does the B TRCP resistant SAC trap the collided ribosome?
I need to read it, sorry. You know where the SAC at And does the beta trip resistant? The question is, is it autophosphorylation of ZAC that modifies the cluster 2? And I believe it is. We get that out of our data because with all these different inhibitors, we can sort out who does it. And I believe that's a ZAC substrate itself, yes. I don't know that blocking degradation of ZAC, I would predict, would stabilize the collision. I think other things are working on the collisions that are downstream of P38. So I think probably not. Yes. I mean, what I think is ZAC is on ribosomes. It's always on ribosomes. And if it goes through it's the most effective thing I've ever seen binding to ribosomes, which means to me it's on ribosomes. It's not exchanging very much. So until this past week, my model that I've been drawing is always a dimer on the ribosome, because the likelihood of two ribosomes colliding together and both having ZAC would be extremely low. But then I've begun to feel anxious because I've been reading all sorts of literature where a lot of these kinases start as monomers. And then I thought, well, maybe it can sort of activate on the ribosome as a monomer, then fall off and find another ZAC that's also fallen off, and then it becomes super active. So they're two steps.
Kind of following up on that question, I wanted to ask, do you have any idea how many collisions it takes for a cell to make this decision? I didn't have an appreciation for 100 to 1 ribosomes to ZAC molecules. Do you think it's 10 collisions have to happen or 1,000 collisions?
I definitely don't have an answer. I mean, you can see from the height of the peaks that, you know, a big collision dose is, let's say, 10 to 20% of the ribosomes are pretty resistant. Still, it's miraculous to me how many ZACs are getting, ZAC gets fully activated in a minute or two. So there's something I don't understand.
It's almost like it's better binding than EI5A.
There is another question from the online audience from Matthias White. GCNI, but not ZACI, inhibits EIF2 phosphorylation. It has been shown that GCN1 binding might depend on ZAC. So the ZAC activity is not required for that event.
I think it's a question about the codependence of binding of these various factors. I think, you know, Daniel's beautiful structure screams out that GCN2 loves collisions because GCN1 is there. And I think that's likely going to be true, though, you know, when we read, you know, David Ron and the English paper, they don't have GCN1 there and GCN2 gets activated, you know, or maybe there, but the P-stalk is enough to do a lot. So I think the jury's still out. We're working on biochemistry, I think, is the answer. Joel.
So the stoichiometry is really interesting, but I wonder if that includes all the non-translating ribosomes, right? So stoichiometry of like a mRNA with polysome, whether it's like one third mRNA with polysome, they're leaving out, you know, stuff that are just individual subunits or monosomes.
Yeah, I mean, it doesn't hang out at the top, which suggests that it likes elongating ribosomes. That's correct. You know, I would say in the cells that we're looking at, they're really actively translating. But in a neuron, there's very few ribosomes translating, and we haven't looked there and to see where Zach, and it allows me to answer the question I really want to answer, which is, do I think these pathways will be different in different cell types and differently sensitized and differently active? Yes, and it'll be super interesting. Tillman.
If I might join in on another question on stoichiometrics. You said there are about 100 ribosomes to one ZAC. So that would mean two consecutive ZACs would be about a 1 in 10,000 case.
Correct.
And so if you have lots of collisions happening, would not just that throw you above the threshold and start signaling?
Sure. I mean, I think that's a possible model, yes. Okay. I think, yes, I could add that model. I think, I don't have a way to answer the question. I think if there are enough collisions, then they would all get in a collision. You're right. But I think so many of the collisions would be empty. And what I see is, you know, so many of the collisions would have one ZAC and one not ZAC. And I see all of it's activated. We see all of it's activated. Okay. The laundry season. Okay.
Thank you.
Maybe a minor question. So in one of your volcano plots in the GCN2 knockout, in the de-enriched fraction, there was CPSF4. So is that just an accident, or is that a possible, you know, feedback loop to the nucleus to stop producing mRNAs that are problematic? Oh, yeah.
I haven't paid attention to that one. That sounds like there's tons of stuff in these data sets that, but yeah. Certainly, I haven't talked at all about the nucleus, and I'm sure cytoplasm and nucleus are talking to one another.
Okay, thank you.
Completely. So, you know, when we began this huge proteomics experiment, we had to decide, do we titrate dose or do we titrate time? And doing both was too much. And, you know, as soon as we did time, we kind of wished we had done dose, but I suspect if we did dose, we would have wished we'd, you know. So I think there's a lot to learn from both, and maybe we need a different method than proteomics though.
Thank you. People are healthily translating the cell, given the rate of elongation and stochastic nature, there must be some level of collisions. Is there an estimate for what fraction of ribosomes are in a collided state during normal translation? And how does this go up with, say, you know, rare?
Sure. Yeah, I mean, I think you can, you know, to the extent that you believe the digestion in normal cells, maybe there's a couple percent. And my answer to this sort of question is always, we don't know what the kinetics are. So it could be that every collision leads to rapid ZAC activation, and then there need to be other mechanisms to keep bringing it down, like localized, you know, MAP kinases, they explode once they get down to the 2 and 1 level. But I think if you can keep it at the 3 level, you can sort of tune it down. So maybe phosphatases deal with that. The other possibility is that, you know, the kinetics are relatively slow and most collisions aren't long lived, and they come and then it takes time to activate ZAC and they resolve before the activation takes place. And I like that answer, but I also think, you know, I think phosphatases are important and I've wholly underplayed them, so.
So we have a question from the audience. Hong Sang is asking whether the ZAC pathway is conserved. So is conserve and conservative, and whether it can exist, for example, in bacteria.
Yeah, I think it's quite conserved in metazoans, higher eukaryote things. We looked for it hard. We looked hard for it in yeast, cerevisiae, and my colleague Sergi said, "You're not right. It's not there. I'm telling you, it's not there." And we ignored him and worked on it for quite a while, and we didn't get it. So I should have listened to Sergi, and I don't think it's in yeast. We've looked hard in all the sort of unicellular eukaryotes, and we haven't found.
Yeah, supposedly a ribosome is negatively charged. Supposedly they should repel each other. So why is the driving force to let them collide?
Well, I think they're moving. You know, the one is definitely stuck. So the idea is that the mRNA is damaged. The lead one just can't move because it can't decode what's coming in. And the next one just lands there. And what, you know, lots of beautiful work, in particular structural work, has shown is that, you know, there really is that structure, and it's a solid, well-resolved structure. But it, you know, it has to overcome some inhibition for sure. Is a collision, I guess. Well, okay, so here's, now I'm gonna back off even on a collision. And Simon will like this, because Simon definitely has been broader in his thinking about this. I think a collision is a great way to get two ribosomes together, but I suspect, I certainly at this stage no longer thinking that Zach is gonna bind to the interface like Hel2. I think Zach binds by that little arm, and the kinase is off the ribosome, and there's something that activates it. So I think there are going to be other ways. I think ribosomes getting close is going to be another way, or, you know, so that's that. There's been a lot of talk about empty A site, full A site, emetine, and anisomycin, and everybody that does an experiment in my lab, they all argue about which one's better and which one's, so I think there are differences, and I think whether ribosomes are hybrid or pre or post translocation, it does matter. And I don't have a great clear answer, but I think it matters. You know, Hanny's worked hard on saying the A site needs to be there. I think there's more to learn.
Okay, one last question.
These are the hard ones.
From Priyanka Singh, he says, does GCN2 depletion have any effect on cell viability upon UV treatment, given that your mass spectrometry data shows an increase in TORC1 substrate?
I think the answer is that definitely the GCN2 depleted cells are more prone to apoptosis because they get the more collisions. And so I think, yes, and TOR is all part of that as well. But okay.
Okay. And thanks again, Rachel.